Welcome to the show. Welcome here live from the Kletter Hotel Gibraltar for our first masterclass of the 2016 Tradewise Gibraltar Chess Festival. And here with me, a very great friend of mine, and David Howell.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, thanks. You've got 2 out of 2, David. You had a great start. You, of course, last year you had a fun. Just tell us about last year's event.
Yeah, I mean, it was a bit of I don't know how to explain it really. I'm kind of hoping that lightning can strike twice, but. Last time, it was nice to get some good results and play some of the top players here.
You came joint second with Huyifan?
No, I came second in my own.
Oh, second in, sorry. Yeah, hey, right. But you drew the last round.
That's sorry. Right. So that was a nervy last day, and it took me a while to calm down afterwards. But no, it's always a pleasure to be here in Gibraltar. Yeah.
So here you're back. Something I really liked is when I asked you about doing this a couple of weeks ago, I sent you a quick message. I mean, I said, would you do a masterclass? And you said, yes, definitely.
Yeah. I think that's the fastest email I've ever sent back. You know? Yes. I mean, it's brilliant. Hopefully it'll be fun.
So what are you going to show us, David?
I thought I'd start by showing everyone the games from this tournament, actually, the first 2 rounds. I mean, I was trying especially hard.
I'm Rodney Perez from Cuba. Okay. We have 2 Cuban players in the tournament. Rodney is one, and Lazaro Brusson is the other.
Okay. Is his son playing? Because Gawain played someone with the same surname.
No, they're not related.
No. Okay. Yeah, anyway, let's get started. So earlier we were talking a bit about preparation with the day's play, and I kind of play every move here with white, but I'd seen that he plays the Petrov, he plays the Slav, he likes his symmetrical structures, so I thought I'd find a way to imbalance things early on. I started with 1c4, but this now transposes to a Panov variation of the Karakhan. So, I won't explain the first few moves too much. Bishop b4 would transpose to a Nimzo Indian, so there's all kinds of transpositions here. He's quite predictable in the opening, so I kind of guessed I'd have this position on the board.
So you had prepared this line?
Briefly. I mean, maybe 20 minutes before the game. As a child, I used to play this opening as white a lot, and I used to play the c3 Sicilian most of the time too. I'm kind of very familiar with these IQPs. I mean, I tried to kick the habit a few years ago, but it's nice to return back to these kind of positions once in a while. So, he played knight f6, which is slightly less common than bishop f6 here. Mm-hmm. Bishop f6, bishop b4, and there's a lot of theory. But I'll just flick through the next few moves quite quickly. And after queen e2, this position, in my preparation, it mostly consisted of going back to the start. And I just want to show something here. So 1e4. This might take a while. c5, c3, d5.
A transposition.
Yeah, and it's not just a transposition. But white, I actually tried to work this out during the game as well, just to make sure. But white is actually a whole tempo ahead. So, bishop b7, knight c3. So, queen d6 is the normal move here, but imagine going queen d8.
Right.
Bishop here. Castles. b6. The line we had, because, I've played this maybe a dozen times in my life. I've got very good experiences with it, and if we compare that, how do we do this? Bishop b7, and then if we compare that to this position, I just have the extra move rook e1, which we'll see in the game, it's an important tempo. Hmm. Knight f6, I'm not saying it's a bad move on move 10, but if white can get a good variation with an extra tempo, then that might need to look for improvements earlier on. So rook c8, actually he played queen d6, before in this position, when white would actually be 2 tempi up on a c3 Sicilian after rook d1. And I've actually seen very strong players do this as black. So, I was hoping for this, but unfortunately he played another very natural move, rook c8.
Also, you could call this a semi-turret, couldn't you?
Yeah,
this opening.
Exactly. I mean, it's a lot of lots of similarities with a lot of different lines. But here, white's plan is very simple. I want to go rook d1. I want to go bishop b1, bishop g5, break with d5 maybe, or after bishop g5, bishop b1 maybe, put my queen on d3 and attack h7. So, my next few moves are quite natural. I mean, if he does move his queen, d6. Again, this would be a c3 Sicilian.
With 2 extra moves.
With 2 extra moves. Wow. So I think it would be, the position with black's rook on d8 and white's bishop on d3. So, I kind of figured there'll be something here with d5, or there'll be some way. I mean, knight e4 might be a threat. So, Yeah, he played knight d5, which, okay. It looks even more strange. He's just played knight f6 a few moves before.
Yes, that's right.
And, I mean, it makes sense in a way. He's trying to kill my attacking ideas by swapping off some pieces. So, for example, if I play bishop b1, which was my first instinct, then knight a5. And this pressure on c3 is quite annoying. And always with IQPs, you have to block them if possible. So this knight on d5 is actually doing a great job now. For example, if knight e4, then he can play a really annoying move, knight f6, keep chasing me around. Knight c3, knight d5. If I go back this way, then he might even put his queen on d5. And suddenly black has kind of everything that he's aiming for in an IQP. Mm. So, I said my preparation was kind of superficial for this game, but I think I
You got the sacrifice on h7, yeah. Knight e5, yeah.
I checked this out just in case it did happen.
On your computer?
On my computer before the game. Yeah. Preparation these days, Stu. You've got to be thorough. You've got to be thorough. So takes, knight g5.
And it's winning, is it?
And it's winning. King g6. There's actually some really nice variations. But okay, queen g4, f5. And white can just play quiet moves now. Queen g3, bishop d6, and just f4.
Yes.
And it's crushing. Black's king is just
sure.
In no man's land. So, okay. Yeah, I checked that out. And I was very tempted to play bishop b1 at the board just to kind of tempt him into this. But okay. I realized that I had another alternative here. I mean, knight takes d5, I hadn't really properly checked in my preparation, but it's a very common idea again in these IQP positions to force through d5. And although he can get a symmetrical pawn structure, which normally he might like, here his bishop on b7 would be blunted.
Mm-hmm.
And okay, I can still try and attack on the king side, maybe just starting with positional moves like knight e5 or bishop f4, even bishop f5. Yeah, maybe knight e5. And okay, I'm going to play on the king side, and his pieces aren't really on great squares, so.
So queen takes d5.
Okay, queen takes d5. Bishop c4. So, yeah, normally in IQPs, you don't want to swap too many pieces off, but here my idea was very, very concrete. If he goes back this way, then d5. I was mostly worried about knight a5 at first, and it looks like black wins a pawn, but there are some nice, mini tactics here with bishop takes b6, and mm-hmm. white ends up just with a very nice structure.
Yes.
For your pawn islands, and now black's the one with the IQP, which the isolated queen's pawn. Queen b4, and again, black's pieces aren't coordinated. The queen on h5 is kind of cut off, and the d-pawn and b-pawns are very weak. So.
And your rookie one, that extra move there, looking really useful.
Exactly, exactly. In nearly every variation, it's a very useful move. Actually, a move I didn't consider, knight d8, might be black's best try, but if that's...
Is that the computer move?
That's the computer move. I didn't even cross my mind at the board. It just looks so unnatural and kind of passive. So yeah, he played knight e5, which I had considered, but I kind of wrote off very early when I started this sequence. Okay, the next few moves are quite forcing. Take, take, and d takes e6. At first, I was considering d6, which looks very nice at first. I think the tactics work in white's favor. f4, and he could have weakness. Black's very active. And it might get cut off from my army, so...
And you haven't weakened his structure?
I haven't weakened his structure, no. So, okay, d takes e6.
Yep.
But, I mean, he had a clever trick in mind, queen e4, threatening my bishop on c4 and checkmate. But...
Did you miss that, David?
No, I saw it just in time, Stuart. So, queen e4, okay, I flick in a check first, king move. And now, okay, I think the move he'd focused on, the move he was worried about, was f3. And again, there's some really nice tactics here.
Because of rook d7 coming.
And rook d7 coming, yeah. But the key difference between this and the game is that black now has bishop h4, and he manages to save some material at least. Actually, during the game, I was calculating this, and I wanted to go g3, just with the idea that after bishop c6, I have this lovely bishop c5 move.
Wow, let's look at this. Bishop c5.
And
comes.
I was getting excited at the board about this variation. I mean, I think white's winning here. If he takes on c5, I can go rook e8, and mm-hmm. I'll cash in if he takes my rook. Okay, and I think there's no way of stopping the f-pawn. So at first I was very tempted by this, but I realized if he just takes here, maybe.
Instead of bishop c6?
Instead of bishop c6 or bishop c8. The difference now is that rook takes, rook e8. He has rook c8, and he's saving everything. And okay, although I could, in this position, I could just take on h4, and I'm still a pawn up, and it's a big pawn on f7. I mean, I thought the drawing margins might be quite high here, just after a move like bishop h5, and I'm not sure. Opposite color bishops. Okay, we'll come to that later, but here maybe there aren't so many chances. So, okay, I'd seen in advance that I had this extra option of queen f1, and again, this rookie one tempo is just so important.
And you're denying him the bishop h4 hitting the rook.
Denying him bishop h4 in that variation, exactly. So now if he starts with queen takes c4, queen takes, rook takes, rook d7, then I'm just picking up a piece and I'll stay at least a pawn or two ahead. So, okay, to justify his previous play, he has to kind of take the material. And now, and he actually has a rook and two bishops now, and although my f7 pawn is still very much alive, there's no way to force it through. Mm-hmm. And I was worried he might be able to set up some fortress. I was worried he might even be better here. So, okay, rook d7.
Yep.
And suddenly, black's piece is all kind of hanging in the air.
This is the game, David. This position.
So, I mean, I got a few comments after the game that my position looked wild and spectators didn't really know what was happening.
Can I ask you, because I know that you often spend a lot of time in your games and get into time trouble. In this game, for example, did you use a lot of time to get to this position?
To get
some of this calculation?
Quite a lot of time. I was always ahead on the clock, actually, in this game. I've been trying to get slightly better. I try and stay within 5 minutes of my opponent either way. So, later on in the game, I did get quite short of time, but I'll show you where I wasted all the time calculating all these nonsense variations. But up to here, actually, I mean, most of my time was spent on this knight takes d5, bishop c4, then d5.
Yes.
Just because it's also forcing. And I'd calculated up to here and a few moves beyond just to make sure that everything was working. So, okay, actually, I was more worried about bishop a6 in this position.
Crumbs.
Yeah, just with the idea that, okay, there's going to be some rook a4 to trap my queen on f1.
Would you play rook takes a7 here?
I could play rook takes a7, and then he plays bishop b5, and he's running away. I can no longer really attack it, because now my rook on a7 is attacked. And, okay, I can always bail out, and I'm never really worse in these positions, but it's going to be hard to win.
Yeah.
So, I figured I had bishop d, maybe bishop d4, not bishop d4, bishop d2 here. And, okay, as far as I can tell, and luckily the computer seemed to agree afterwards, but as far as I could tell during the game, this was working for white, wherever he moves his queen now. And, okay, he has some tricks with rook g4, maybe, which I was slightly worried about during the game.
Mm-hmm.
But what's I thinking here? Maybe even a move like rook e8 to bail out at some point. Am I missing something here, Stuart?
I don't know.
He should have tried something like this anyway. So, okay, bishop c6.
This moves like rook e8 at the end there, don't quite work do they, for you.
Rook e8, I'm not sure.
No.
Okay.
I think so.
It's been a long day.
A half chance. So bishop a6.
So bishop a6. Maybe. I mean, that was the move I was worried about during the game. I mean, it looks so unnatural. It's kind of relying on tricks working. But rook takes c7. So, yeah, the idea now is that his rook on c4 is going to be attacked. I thought about flicking in f3, but the variations after rook takes f7 and everyone's pieces are hanging, it was just too mind-boggling, so I kind of stopped calculating there. I mean, maybe I can still bail out with rook takes e7, but it felt like too much of a mess, so. Yeah. Okay, when in doubt, keep things under control. So, actually, in this position, I completely, I mean, I don't know really what happened to me, I completely missed queen d7, which is such a natural move to defend the bishop. I mean, this was where I started getting into time trouble. Queen b7 was the move that I was focused on just to attack g2. And here, I was calculating some really, really nice variations, starting with rook d1, just to stop black taking on f7. For example, there's going to be some back rank checkmates. And for example, if he takes on g2, queen b4, again, so if rook takes f7, rook d8, if he defends the
Queen takes f7, though, David?
Yeah, I'll come to queen takes f7. Okay, yeah, and here, sorry, I was getting carried away calculating variations like queen takes and then bishop g5, and white wins.
Really?
With rook d8 coming.
Goodness me.
So, okay, black can stop the pawn, but he at the end, this g2 bishop will always be on pre. This idea. But after queen takes f7, okay, I'd go
rook d7. Yeah.
And the key is that after queen f3 to defend his bishop, queen d4 to attack g7, rook g8.
Oh, beautiful. Queen takes g7. David Howell.
But okay, I wasted all my time calculating these.
Show us some mate, come on.
Yeah,
show
and bishop d4, yeah. And it'll be mate next move.
Beautiful.
But so this was what I was thinking during the game, and I was already patting myself on the back, and I felt like a right idiot when he played queen d7, stopping my rook d1 idea. Okay, now I don't have to worry about g2, but...
So you're losing f7, basically?
I'm losing f7, yes.
Because right. I saw position with...
Rook c1, bishop back, queen c7. So although he now manages to win my f7 pawn, I mean, he's still not fully coordinated. And, okay, opposite colour bishops, there are some drawing chances, but here, while the major pieces are on the board, g7's a big weakness, and he can't actually get the queens off, because I'm always kind of penetrating to the 7th rank, and yep. I'll win the a7 pawn at least. In a lot of lines, so okay, I'm still quite optimistic here. There's no risk, so king g8, queen g3, okay, threatening rook c7. Mm-hmm. So rook c8, rook e1. So it's just important to keep as many pieces on the board as I can, just to minimise the drawing chances and to keep threatening his king. And here, okay, rook d8, okay, f3. Okay, here he made a big mistake in time trouble.
F3, that's a nice move, f3.
Yeah, f3.
That's the difference between the positions. If he had a pawn on f6 across, he'd be...
Exactly, exactly. So I was just wanted to cover g2 and give my king some breathing space.
Just show us why he can't play rook takes bishop.
Yeah, so rook takes bishop now is unfortunately fails to queen b8 and queen f8. And now, okay, just rook e8 at the very minimum. So so f3, I just thought I'd avoid any tricks while I was short on time. Just keep everything covered. And now, okay, he made a mistake. He should just play bishop c6, maybe, just to defend e8, so he can try and challenge my rook next move by playing rook e8.
Yes.
And he gets out of the trick, which happened in the game. But, okay, I can't really get away with playing king h7 to try and play his rook to g8, because I can even just take now on h6. So rook g8 I can block with bishop g5, and if he takes, then I can go check. Yep. And I pick up his rook on d8. So. Yep. I mean, he wins my b2 pawn, I win his a7 pawn, but eventually the f and g pawns will tell. Mm-hmm. He didn't make me show my technique, luckily, so he resigned in this position.
Efficient, very efficient game.
Efficient, but yeah, I mean, I feel like I played quite well, and I didn't make any obvious mistakes, but I was slightly annoyed at myself after the game for not considering a couple of his options.
Well, you missed queen d7.
Queen d7, such a basic move, it's a nice to get into things by forcing yourself to try for tactics in round one just to warm up. So.
Yeah, good game, nice game.
Yeah. I thought if there's time, I'd like to show my second, because there are actually a lot of similarities.
By all means, we have time. Game. Please, David, too. Yeah. And you're saying the similarities with this game?
I mean, we'll come to that. But again, my second game, there were opposite colour bishops and major pieces on the board. And again, I managed to trick him with some opening preparation move order things. So,
how important at your level, top professional level, is it to get a really good opening like that? I mean, is it like you get your preparation in, like today, game? Yeah, you prepared something, even maybe not...
No,
spent
sure.
too much time on it, then to actually have it on the board, it's probably true of all strengths.
Yeah, I mean, it's always nice. It's a big confidence boost if you feel prepared, if you feel ready. And it saves, I mean, especially for people like me who spend a lot of time on the clock, if you can get the first 15 moves down on the board without really thinking, then, okay, you're nearer the time control, just much more comfortable. So, I mean, preparation is hard work, and, I mean, the rewards for putting in that hard work are often not seen for years. I mean, sometimes you'll prepare a variation and it'll come up 6 years later, but...
And can you still remember it?
very rarely.
6 years?
I mean, that's happened to me a few times recently. I mean, Gibraltar last year, one of the key games I'd prepared, I think, 4 years in advance, and I hadn't looked at it since, and I couldn't remember at the board. I just knew that, okay.
Which game was that, David? Remind us.
Against Naroditsky in the penultimate round. But, I one move after I played my new idea, I was already, I couldn't move.
Nice.
Okay. I always recommend to do your preparation, kids.
Do we have the second game ready to go? The second game, who did you play, David?
Today I played a young, talented, I am from Cyprus, is that right? Kiliris.
Oh, Kiliris, yeah, okay.
So, I mean, looking at his games, he's...
Yesterday when they came. But I think he... Just talking about, I mean, he won or came second in a sort of European.
Yeah, I think
youth
in the under-16s.
Under-16s. Yeah, I mean, he's good.
He's very good.
No
yeah,
question.
I mean, he's
good.
Tactically very sharp. I mean, his opening repertoire is very solid.
And the first player we ever had from Cyprus, as far as I remember, in 14 years. So it's nice.
Breaking records all the time, Stuart.
Absolutely. Yeah. So this is your game from today, David.
This is my game from today. I was black. So d4, knight f6, c4. And, okay, I've got a bit of a reputation as a Grünfeld player. I've also been dabbling in other openings recently. But Henry here, he hadn't played d5 for many years, which is kind of the move which aims to punish c5 at least, and then it could end up in a Benoni or a Benko. Or
you don't have to tell us what you're going to play.
I won't reveal what I was going to play. But
check Benoni.
Yeah, I would already be out of book here. So d5. Yeah, but okay. He stuck to his repertoire. He played knight f3, and we've actually transposed to an English opening here. So we normally get this position with c4, c5, and move one, knight c6, and I mean I'd noticed he'd never actually had this position. Okay, as far as I could tell.
Right.
All of his opponents were playing e6, and then, I mean, he's a Catalan player, so he normally goes g3, and he's very happy. But after knight c6, okay, he played knight c3 now. If g3, then black has extra options. I mean, I've played queen a5 check here before. e5 is a move, d5 is a move. So, okay, I won't reveal what I was planning to play. But, okay, so he played knight c3, and already I felt this was a small game for me, getting into unfamiliar territory. e6. And I've actually played a lot of this from the white side, so I know a few things here. a3, bishop c5. Yeah, the normal move is bishop e7 or d5. Again, I played d5 here last year in Gibraltar. Bishop c5, knight b3, bishop b6. And, okay, I kind of guessed that he might play this move before the game. I hadn't checked it much to my annoyance at the board, but he played g3, which I'm not sure has ever been played here.
Really?
I mean, it fits with his repertoire. He's a Catalan player. He always wants to finchetto. But here, I mean, it's kind of critical to go e4 to stop me going d5.
Yes.
Well, I mean, d5 is actually the main move here, but to at least pretend to stop me playing d5. Okay. And, okay, the game goes on. It could end up in a hedgehog structure, or after d5, the centre kind of explodes. But, okay, so after g3, d5. And again, at the board, I was...
So you think this is
happy.
Almost a new position, is it?
Probably, yeah. I mean, actually, if we do what I did in the first game, if we take a little detour.
By all means.
Sorry.
By all means.
After d4, knight f6, c4, g6. I mean, again, as a Grünfeld player most of my life, I recognize the position we had on the board. How's this going? Knight f3, bishop g7, e3, castles, cd5, knight d5, bishop c4, knight b6, bishop b3, c5. Castles. And if we look at this position, I think this is what we have on the board, except black would have the extra a6 move, which is not necessarily useful. So if we go back to d5, where is this? d5. Okay, haven't got bishop g2 and castles, but yeah, in fact, I've got an exact transposition to an opening I would normally have with white, except he's got this a3 move, which is actually counterproductive in a lot of positions. His knight on b3 is a bit loose.
Yes.
So, okay, I was very happy with this. I mean, normally...
So a very flexible approach to the openings has paid dividends twice, really.
Yeah, exactly. And another theme that I had in common with my first game, I mean, it's something I'm always trying to look out for. I'm always trying to be sneaky in the opening.
Move order tricks.
Move order tricks. And, I mean, everybody has openings that they're very familiar with. And if I can somehow, not trick my opponent, but if I can somehow get that with opposite colours, then I'll already know a few things here and there. So I won't get caught up too often. But here, I mean, okay, the normal line would be take, bishop g2, d4, and this is exactly the Grünfeld line with colours reversed, again with this a3 move.
Yes.
And we'll see that this knight in b3 might be weak when black plays bishop e6 at some point. Anyway, he played a very ambitious move here, all credit to him. I mean, c5 is...
I saw he played that.
Yeah, I mean, it might look anti-positional because it kind of gives me the centre, but at the same time, it's... So, I mean, it has its points here, again, and, I mean, this was familiar to me, here I played h6.
That move to me is not obvious at all, h6.
No, I mean, okay, I'll explain it by going back to this position, castles, and here, as black, I've actually played c4, which is an exact copy of what he's done. Bishop c2, knight c6, and now... one of my opponents wants, I mean, this is going back to 2006 probably, but one of my opponents once played h3 against me. And I found it very annoying to face. I think Mamajarov actually won a nice game against Pelletier, if I remember. He had the black side after queen e2. And now we see why h3 comes in useful. Bishop g4, h3, take, take, e5. Now white should take. If d5, knight b4, so take, and now queen e7. And black's got a very, very good position. He takes on e5, he's coming into d3 with the knight. So after, okay, after playing eight, okay, if I'd played queen e7, that would transpose nearly directly after bishop g5. So I thought I'd be clever and play this h6 move.
I like this a3, h6 color, or?
Yeah, no, sure. I mean, I'd like to pretend I was being sophisticated on purpose, but normally this kind of thing doesn't happen to me. So h6, yeah. And I mean, in that game, I actually played f5, so that would kind of correspond to f4, f4 here, with the idea that, okay, white's going to break with e4 at some point. And I mean, this is a very interesting move, f4. But he seemed to, he wasn't really sure what to play here, I think. I mean, if he breaks with e4 immediately, which is kind of the natural move, then d4, knight b5, and although he takes the bishop pair, I think it's more important that I have a very strong center. His knight on b3 again is a bit loose. And after a move like f4, rook d8, I mean, he's not really in time to go f5 and attack me on the king side, because I think I'm going to break through first. And bishop a6, and maybe even d3 at some point. And if he takes on e5, then I can even just play a move like knight g4, and I'll put my knight on e5. Beautiful outpost.
Yes.
So if he can't break with e4, though, then his position, I mean, it's difficult to find a plan. If he moves his queen away, queen c2, then I can start with e5. If he plays, I mean, he's got no good squares for the bishop. So maybe f4 is interesting, but it's not really so obvious for someone who hasn't looked at this opening.
F4, you think, might be the best move anyway.
Yeah, but yeah, giving that tip for free. So e3, queen e7. So my idea is very simple as black. My plan is to go rook d8 and build up for e5, maybe with b6 at some point. But I also want to tie down his knight on b3 to protecting c5. Five now, so he stops me. And okay, all my pieces are kind of on the optimal squares for now, at least. So I thought I'd kind of initiate concrete play with a5. And although his pawn on a3 stops me going knight b4, I mean, it does mean that his knight on b3 is always a target. And here my idea is just to go a4 and pick up c5 pawn.
Right.
And if he puts his knight on a4 to block me, I don't really care that he comes into
then
b6.
You go e5.
I just go e5 and bishop g4 is coming. I kind of lured his rook to d1, so I always have bishop g4 tricks. And okay, I can even play d4 myself, or even e4 sometimes. And I mean, he's got a bad version of a Grünfeld, really. So okay, after a5, knight b5, bishop b8. I love the bishop pair, so
yeah,
I
now
try
you
to keep
the bishop
it at all costs. Now he surprised me, actually. He played e4.
Because there you could have played e5, but
I could have played
e5. Why would you? Yeah, you could have played e5.
No, exactly. I mean, it might well be a stronger move objectively, actually. I mean, for example, takes. If he stops, I mean, he probably shouldn't play a4 himself. But I mean, my plan now, for example, might be to go e4, bishop g4, and knight e5, and I just clamp down on the light squares. And I'm not really missing my c7 bishop so much, but okay.
You wanted to have everything.
Yeah, I'm a greedy guy. So bishop b8. Yeah, so e4 surprised me completely. I mean, he's played e3. He's kind of shied away from any central breaks. And here, especially when his knight can't take on e4. But okay, I mean, it's hard to find another move, actually. I'm just going e5 next.
Yeah.
So e4, a4. I think his idea is if I take with the knight, I can get his kind of his best bishop, but whoops. But suddenly I lose a bit of coordination. So queen takes, bishop e3, and he doesn't even take back this e4 pawn. He goes rook d1.
And knight d6.
And knight d6, and although I might well still have a good position, I didn't really want to go so passive with all my pieces on the back rank, and yeah, I wasn't so sure. So, okay. Again, I wanted everything. I wanted a4, kind of implementing all my plans. So, knight d4. Again, if he goes back, then he's lost control over this d4 square. So now I push, and it's going to be a protected pass pawn after I go e5. It's important that he can never go knight c4 because his c5 pawn's on pre-ego. Whoops. And if he can't go knight c4, then he's just very badly organized. So, knight then takes. Yeah, so knight takes d4. Now I can take on e4. And I no longer have to kind of let him get into d6 with his knight.
Yes.
And for example, he's going to walk into. Okay, I can take on c5 here. He's also walking into a pin sometimes with e5.
Yeah.
But, so he took with a rook. d4, bishop d7. So again, developing with tempo. I plan to play knight takes e4 here, and even though after thinking for a while, I realized that bishop d7 was a better move, but I just couldn't let go of this thought of taking on e4 with my knight. eventually forced myself to.
Did you spend a long time over that move?
Yeah, I did actually. I mean, I just love the bishops, two bishops so much that knight takes e4 was just so tempting for me. But I think this is stronger, bishop d7. He actually has a problem defending this knight now. If he tries to be clever and takes on a4, then take, queen takes c5, and that pin's going to be deadly. Sure. If he comes back with the knight, then I have a key move, bishop e5 now.
Not queen takes c5.
No, queen takes c5 maybe, but then bishop e3, and suddenly I'm the one who's going to have to start retreating. And suddenly I'm not looking so organized with my bishop on b8. And
well, knight g4 there, but.
Maybe knight g4. Sharper than me, stupid.
Still got it, David.
I was worried about this, but yeah, you're right, just knight takes e3. Mm. Okay, so that's why he didn't play knight c3. But bishop e5, I think, is equally strong. Bishop e5, and okay, he has to go back. And for example, sorry, just to show d4 here. I can even go d3 now. Queen d1 and d2. Pushing the passed pawns, and okay, I'll win a knight on a4 now.
That's epic. That d-pawn.
That d-pawn, yeah. So, after bishop d7, yeah, it's important as well that after e takes d5, bishop takes d6. I mean, his pawns, I have d7 for the queen and I've got a blockade, so his pawns aren't going anywhere. I'll just go bishop c6, yeah. Next move and consolidate. Yeah. Okay, so knight d6. But now I win a pawn for free, and okay, I mean, he's got the two bishops, which is some compensation, but I have outposts and a lot of light squares. Actually, here, I took on d5 with the knight. He mentioned to me after the game that e5 was the move he was afraid of, and I mean, I checked it very briefly afterwards, and it looks like he's right, actually. I mean, suddenly my piece has just come to life. I just saw a free pawn, and I thought, let's just take it.
Even though he has the bishops.
Even though he has the bishops, I'm going to win d5, I'm going to come into c2, and actually, I'm probably just clearing up. Okay, I mean, knight takes d5, there's nothing wrong with, but I wasn't sure if he should keep the bishops here and then just leave me this d5 outpost as well as the extra pawn, just by playing bishop d2 or something. But I'll play bishop c6, and eventually I'll move the knight and swap off the light squared bishops, maybe. And I don't know. I mean, maybe he has more chance of kind of building some kind of fortress here. Just put his queen on d1, or just try to hold. I mean, it's a bit miserable for white. But instead, he gave up this bishop.
Difficult choice, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's a difficult choice. I mean, opposite colour bishops, I'm a pawn up.
Yeah.
And here, the key factor is that his light squares are just always going to be weak. Mm. So, I mean, if his pawn was back on g2, then I wouldn't really be holding high hopes for an advantage at all. But here, as we'll see after...
Well, then he might have played e5, in fact, with his pawn on g2. Then he probably would have played
e5. Definitely would have played e5. Yeah. But, so... Here, unfortunately, it's very hard for him to block up those holes. I mean, he needs to at some point play f3, king f2, but I mean, that leaves other problems. I can always go queen h3, and so here, rook e8. So, yeah, it's very important that I stop him from taking the e-file. And it doesn't really matter that he can take the extra pawn back, because now suddenly we see why this g3 pawn is misplaced. I mean, for example, here, queen e4.
He's going to have to give the exchange, isn't he?
Yeah, he can give a pawn, but again, it's miserable. And actually, here's it's virtually exactly the same pawn structure as my other game. I have the extra f pawn, which
that's true, actually, yeah.
Yeah, which really helps my cover my king. And at some point, okay, it's going to be a slow win. I can go bishop back to c6 and move my queen round to this long diagonal. But I'm pretty sure it should be winning eventually. I mean, his king's just too weak. So he actually wants to leave me with that d pawn as kind of a self blockade. But so he played rook c1, bishop b5. So I was just kind of pretending that I'll put my bishop on c4 just to kind of lock down the queen side. Mm. I mean, I wasn't actually sure, but okay. Once he kicked me away, I knew I'd definitely come back to c6. And this might look like a passive square at first, but it actually ties down his rook, because as soon as his rook moves away, I'm just going to give away my pawn d4. Without thinking, yeah, and hopefully mate him on g2.
Like bullet chess or something.
Exactly, yeah. Just play first, think later. But so for example, if he ever, rook d2, d4, and that bishop on c6, and this is now a monster. So, okay, bishop d2. So he really wanted to challenge this e-file. If he doesn't challenge, then I'm just going to slowly go rook e7, rook ae8, and I might even push with g5 on the king side. I'm going to break through eventually. So bishop d2, so f6. So again, like my f3 move in the last game, I thought I might as well just cover g7. If he puts his bishop on c3, I might have to play it anyway. So
the same move as before, right?
Same move, yeah. Ideas just always crop up in chess. Any color, any position. So rook c3. Yeah, that one surprised me. I mean, I thought it was my plan to come in anyway, and now kind of queen e2 gains in strength. I mean, I think his original idea was to swap rooks, but now actually after takes, suddenly he can no longer defend f1.
Ouch.
And although he can still struggle on with h4, I hear I can play rook c8 or even rook e8. Yeah, and yeah, I'm going to checkmate him only 10 minutes here. I spent my remaining time just convincing myself not to play bishop b5. I really wanted to just improve my position without calculating. And I just saw that bishop b5 might be winning immediately. But it is winning immediately. Actually,
is this the game? No, you didn't.
No. I chickened out of bishop b5, much to my shame. But after rook d2, I have this nice rook e4 move, and actually I'm coming out a piece up. I was worried about this at first. I thought, okay, this was just as a reason not to play this. But the reason I didn't play it in the end is after rook takes e3, fe3, queen takes f5. I wasn't sure here whether the position with opposite color bishops is more favorable, or this is because, okay, I'll lose d5 and maybe b7, and his king's still very weak. I mean, maybe I can check first and then, I don't know. Actually, the reason I rejected this was because I wasn't sure my rook could get in, but okay, maybe rook c8 and queen, it's coming in at some point. I just thought I couldn't get in on the e-file, so. Okay, this might have been a quicker win, but rook e5, when in doubt, just improve your pieces, I think.
Yeah. That's a good quit.
So, yeah. That's what I tell myself, wasting my time on the clock.
I mean, if White's bishop were on d4, and there's sort of a different piece arrangement, it'd be different.
Exactly, if the bishop were on d4, and if he managed to get off a pair of rooks, maybe. Mm. If he managed to swap queens, then he's out of danger completely. So, that's why I kind of ran away with my queen here, and why I ran away again. If he swaps queens, then he no longer has to worry about checkmate. So, and as we'll see, I kind of tempted him.
But he still can't play bishop d4.
No, he still can't play bishop d4. Yeah, but I tempted him to remove his rook. And here, probably the only move is to go back.
Right.
I mean, it's miserable to kind of admit defeat and just start pushing maybe g5, maybe f5, or maybe even just push my h pawn at some point. Okay, my plan was maybe to go g5, queen h3 at some point, and just kind of wait for something to appear. But he can barely move. I mean, maybe his best plan is to just go rook d2, rook d3, and wait. So, it's understandable he wanted to keep trying to swap queens, but here he lets me gain time. Decisively, even.
With f5, and then d4.
Yeah, d4's coming. I mean, d4 immediately I wasn't so sure, because I can't really get my queen onto the long diagonal, and he's coming to d6 or d8, and he's going to swap off pieces. I mean, it's probably still good, but okay, I thought g5, just throw more stuff in, f4. Mm. And, these weaknesses on the king's side come to, they tell in the end anyway. So bishop takes f4, rook e1 check.
Yes.
Rook takes f4, and it's important that d4 now works. Even if it hadn't worked, I would have played it. I probably had 30 seconds to get to move 40 here, but.
But because of bishop b5 coming as well.
Bishop b5's coming, queen h3 is coming, bishop g2's coming. So if we just quickly go through, here, bishop takes d4. I mean, he's covering h3 with his rook, but I can check and check. If he takes with the d rook, then now bishop b5. Mm-hmm. And king e1, rook g1. If here, then okay, I can do anything, rook d8 or rook d5. I'm going to cash in. So he took this way, and after queen h3, he resigned. The idea is I'm picking up his queen after everything.
Sure.
Bishop f3, and king e1, rook g1. So again, the breakthrough often comes with a pawn break on the opposite color of your bishop, but here it was decisive. And that's why the initiative is so important with these opposite color bishops. Mm-hmm. Positions. So, yeah.
Well, once again, I would use the word efficient. Sorry, and just very sort of clean and sort of route one. But you made it look easy. I'm sure it wasn't.
Well, it didn't feel so easy. But I'm
two good pieces of opening preparation, or the openings that came on the board with things that you sort of knew a lot about or felt
about. It's lucky it doesn't always happen that way, but it's always nice when you can surprise the opponent rather than the other way around. So. Yeah.
Would you take a question or two from the audience
of
those games or something else? Yeah, Fernando.
When you play queen f1, if he goes rook c4 in the first game.
Yes.
I'm not sure exactly right now.
Sure.
How far away do you calculate the rook d7 resource? Because even when you played it, it wasn't clear to me that it's going to work.
Okay. Question from the first game.
It's a pretty complex variation. You show after bishop a6 and all that.
Yeah.
I mean, in general, how much of what you've shown us just now, if I could sort of paraphrase it a bit or change it, of, in both games, how much of what you've seen, what you've showed is things you saw at the board, and how much is sort of stuff you've looked at on or found on the computer subsequent to the games?
Yeah, so, I mean, most of the stuff, I mean, I've checked for maybe 2 minutes with an engine afterwards, so, I mean, most of the stuff I've shown today is what I saw at the board.
Right.
Actually, this... the exact position you mentioned with this queen f1 resource and then rook takes c4, rook d7. I mean, that's all very forcing. So actually, when I played knight takes d5, queen takes d5, bishop c4, before I even broke with d5, I'd seen up to this position. And I saw I had maybe three or four options there. I mean, I could play f3, which is no risk at all, rather than queen f1. I mean, I knew that was an option to fall back on if my calculations didn't work. Also, I saw after rook takes c4, as well as rook d7, I can play bishop d2 and bail out into some position. I can play bishop d4 or bishop g5, and I think, okay, I might not be better in some of those positions, but I knew there was no risk, really. I can always bail out. But okay, when I got to the position, I double-checked rook d7, and if bishop a6 doesn't work, then it's just winning on the spot. So, okay, I was still slightly worried of the board, but you can never be sure, but... I mean, especially with these forcing things, that's why I kind of waste all my time. I just get carried away with these variations.
Is there a way that you can ultimately?
Yeah, I wish I could say there was a surefire way of doing it, but I mean, normally it's just a jumble of variations in the head. But I mean, the way I train is, I mean, on certain websites you can do this, there are tactics trainers, and I just, I answer them on instinct. I try and calculate everything, just every possible semi-sensible move, just to make sure that I'm not blundering anything. And especially at the board, I always like to, I mean, when I calculate things, I always like to make sure there's always a fallback option. So you're not kind of going all in every hand, or you can always bail out into something slightly safer if your calculation goes wrong. So, I mean, the whole cliche with candidate moves that sometimes comes into it. So I saw in the first game we were talking about, he had no real options after this knight e5, knight takes e5, queen takes e5, d6, this. I mean, from there on, he had no options. I mean, it's all forced for him. And I knew that I had two or three different moves every time. So, okay, it's always nicer when things are forced, but even when they're not, it's okay. Calculating can be fun.
And any general questions for David, maybe, or anything either on one of those games or about... because you've had a great year, David. I mean, well, just tell us about the year, since you had that great result in Gibraltar last year. So 12 months down the line, just tell us briefly about your last year.
Yeah, I mean, it's been a... bit of a roller coaster for me. I mean, I've been playing pretty much non-stop. I mean, I took maybe a month or so break in May, but other than that, in May, June. But
you play a lot?
I've been playing a lot. I've been doing a bit of coaching, doing a few events.
You played recently in Tallinn, didn't you?
That's right. I did okay in a rapid play recently. I came second behind Kovalenko. I mean, I managed to play some of the best chess I've played in a long time. But actually, after Gibraltar last year, for the next 6 months, I managed to kick on. I got to 20 on the live list, even. It's been a bit of a steep drop since that, but and then between August and December, I was lacking energy, and I played some good tournaments, but more often than not, I was kind of drawing winning positions or kind of failing to defend slightly worse positions, and I felt I was playing well within myself, and okay, the rating points were dropping away. But in December, I played the London Chess Classic.
Yes,
there was a British knockout, and I managed to win that. Okay, I feel slightly re-energized and ready for another push at 2700.
I was going to ask him, what drives you forward? What is it that drives? Because I know you're very motivated.
Yeah,
and very.
I always try and set a goal or two, and my current goal is to get British number one. I got to within 12 points of Mick Adams.
Yeah.
And then during the course of one tournament we were both playing, and the gap changed to 50 points. I lost so many points and he gained so many that it was back to square one. But I guess that's the next goal. Although, I mean, that's not a deal breaker for me. I'll just...
Do you kind of thrive on that sort of rivalry?
I used to think so, but I think I'm just getting old. I think I'm more chilled out at the board nowadays. I don't really care as much, and I mean, I just want to try and enjoy it and play as good chess as possible. I'm no longer as bloodthirsty as I was. I mean, I don't mind a few quiet games now and then.
But you work hard, you train hard.
Work harder than ever. I used to be very lazy. I used to just play the C3 Sicilian every game and just hope for the best. But now I try and mix it up, and I'm always watching current events. I mean, that's the kind of way I work on chess, actually. I don't sit down and just study. I kind of just have commentary for big events on in the background. I dress
Captain Clear and some of
no comment. So. yeah, I do actually. Yeah. Especially places like this. I mean, surrounded by great people, and I'm going to get all soppy now. But
no, it's, we love
it's,
having you here.
Yeah, it's a great atmosphere, and events like this really kind of. So, yeah, get on with it really, and just keep trying
An ultimate
improve,
aim to be world champion.
I think is that again, I'm far too old.
Did you ever think about or?
It crossed my mind when I was about 8, but from a young age. I mean, I managed to keep up with them until we were about 13, 14. Already from a young, you know, after that, I kind of realised it was maybe beyond me.
But you feel that you're not that far away from them now, in fact?
I feel I'm closer than I have been in a long time. And I still feel I've got another few levels to hit, but I'm not putting any pressure on myself. You know, I'm enjoying it and I'm surviving, so.
Very good.
Yeah, well, I'll just keep going.
Maybe a final question from the floor, because we're hoping, I think, Maria, if she's here, is going to give us a class. Yeah, your next plans, David, after this?
After this, I'm planning to take a long break. I'll play some league games and things. I mean, I'll just relax, I'll watch the candidates, I'll enjoy watching chess for a while. Yeah, exactly. No, I'll work on my fitness, work on my chess, and hopefully come back. I can't seem to hide away from it. It's always there in the background. Like, no matter what I'm doing, I might be, you know, well, I don't even know what I do between tournaments, but it's always just there. Like I'll have my iPad on, just kind of the last few days. But I like to know what's going on, and I like to know everyone and everything that's in the chess world. So
good.
That must mean I love the game in a way. But yeah, I just need to go away for a while and regroup. So.
Okay. Last year. Was probably your best ever tournament, do you think,
probably.
This time last year?
Yeah. I mean, the way I was playing and the way I was feeling, it's probably the best form I've felt in a long time. I mean, I've had maybe comparable results, like third at the London Classic once and things, but I never felt I was at my best, and here last year I felt I was near.
And you've played guys like Kramnik and Magnus, and you've played all these guys, haven't you?
Yeah, I've been very lucky in my career. I mean, they've given me a few bad. It's hard to get the opportunity. I mean, I play maybe... I mean, one or two of them a year, and it's. I feel like, you know, if I did get the opportunity, I'd be able to do a bit better than I did in the past. I mean, actually, at the time when I was playing all those London Chess Classics against Kramnik, against Carlsen, I was at university, and I didn't feel I was able to properly be there for now. Should.
And welcome back. And part two of the show. And here I'm joined by the reigning women's world champion, Mariya Muzychuk. Mariya, welcome back to Gibraltar.
Thanks.
How many times have you played in this event? Do you know? Many times, no?
Yes, I think it's my fifth time here.
Okay, your fifth time. Your first time as world champion.
Yeah, yes.
So this time last year, of course. Just tell us quickly, before we look at the game, you're going to show us your game from today, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah? Just tell us a little bit before that about how it feels to be world champion, and just quickly.
It's an amazing feeling to be the world champion.
Yeah? What was the... I mean, you beat Natalia in the fight in the match?
Yeah, it was Natalia, but you played the final match.
Yeah. And since then, what was it like when you got back home, the reception of your family and friends and in the Ukraine and everything?
Yes, I traveled to Lviv, and so there were so many cameras, I really didn't expect this. It was a big pleasure for me.
Right. So you're a big star in the Ukraine. You were anyway, but now, like, since you won the World Championship, you must have been on TV all the time and that kind of thing?
Well, chess is not so popular in Ukraine, but...
Is it not, no?
Yeah, but I can say that in my town, in Lviv, so I'm quite famous.
Right.
Yeah, many people can recognize me, even when I went to this tournament, so...
This one, Hinge?
At the airport, so he looked through my passport and said, oh, probably you're going to the next tournament? I said, yes.
And how is it that you and Anna, your sister Anna, have become two of the, I mean, for a long time now, two of the best female players in the world? I mean, just quickly, then we'll look at the game. Does that come from your mum or dad, or how is it you together you've grown up to be so strong, both of you?
Well, each other, we travel a lot. And
okay, but she's 2 years older than you? What's the difference?
2.5 years.
2.5
years older.
All right. So were you always, she started chess first, of course, so you always wanted to be at the same level or catch her up, or was it sort of rivalry? Or
well, but I can't say that it was my main aim just to become better than my sister. So I just ended.
When you were 2 years old?
At 3, you could play a normal game. So.
3 years old, goodness. It's amazing. Okay, go on, tell us a little bit more, and then we'll look at the game. And then what? So this was in Lvov? Yeah? Or
No. My parents live about 70 kilometers from Lviv.
Okay.
But when I started to go to the university, so then I moved to Lviv, and currently I'm living in Lviv.
Okay, right. And so Anna and you, of course, best friends, and do you study chess together? How does that work? Do you train together?
Yeah, we practice chess together, so we play many of the same tournaments.
Mm-hmm.
It's good.
It's good, okay. Brilliant. Okay, so you're going to show us your game today against...
Yes.
Codinotti is his name?
It's Codinotti Marco.
Marco Codinotti from Italy, yeah? I think
yes.
He's an IM, isn't he? Yeah. Okay, so off we go. So Maria, to show us the game from today.
Well, it was an interesting game.
First of all, what color did you have?
Went wrong. So let's check. Okay, knight c6 here. So probably it's not the best move, but of course a possible one. So also here, black can play bishop g4.
G5. G5, no. G5? Hey, why not? Let's look at G5. Maybe it's not so bad, G5.
No, okay, knight bd7 is also possible,
yeah.
So these all moves are good, so difficult to say which one is better.
All right, but you've chosen like a sideline against the Sicilian here,
Well, but I can't say that I prepared a lot before this game. Knight c6. D4.
Yeah, this can be quite sharp.
Yes, and here are some crazy lines after knight e4. Knight e4, d5. Queen a5. Knight c3. Knight e5.
Yes.
And here are two moves are possible, knight e5 and castle. And I can say that lately castle is played more often.
Right.
I like this position with white. It's good compensation for a pawn.
You've had this before, have you? Have you played this line before this position?
Yes. I remember that once I played a game, but it was very long ago. Mm-hmm. Actually, here my opponent started to think. And so probably he didn't know this line.
Right.
And just wanted to escape all these variants. So d5. Here I have a good plan, knight e1, f3. What I what I did in my game. So bishop g4. And during the game I started h3, then bishop f5. And now I can't play knight e1 and f3 because of this square on g3.
Right,
yes, and that's why I didn't play h3. So I have decided to play bishop e3. And I have played knight e1 here. During the game, I remembered that one time I analyzed queen b6. Queen b6, f3, knight d4, queen d1. Okay, I won a piece, but I wasn't so sure in all these variations because I analyzed them so alone and the computer wasn't so good that time. So during the game I thought, okay, maybe what is good here.
Something with bishop c5.
Yeah, bishop c5, okay, I can take. I think it's okay for white. It must be okay. So h6.
Okay. Just to get the knight out.
Yeah, and then just to have the square h7 for this knight. So here, of course, I didn't want to play h4 just because my king will become very weak.
Yes.
So I wanted to play f4. But immediately to play it, for example, take, take. And I don't see how white can win this pawn on e4.
And he has this great square for his queen.
Yes, d5, this d5 squares. My knight on e1 is not so good placed at the moment. So during the game I played queen d3, castle f4.
Right.
And here I have to say that my opponent played very good. Of course I would be happy after knight h7. I think white is clearly better there. So I think the knight b4, queen b1, knight e4 is very strong. So
better to give a pawn and be active.
Yeah, just to sacrifice a pawn.
Yes.
Of course I calculated knight e4, de. Queen. And here I think black has enough compensation for a pawn. I said maybe queen b1, but anyway, my pieces are on the first rank.
Yeah, it doesn't feel very good for white.
Yes, it is not what I wanted to get.
But was queen d3 the right move? Did you play the right move, queen d3 and f4, do you think?
Okay. Which one you think is better? Just try
could
to
you play? Could you play a3 before you played f4?
Here a3.
Well, you know, all the same plan: queen d3 followed by a3. Was it too slow? Was it a bit slow?
Maybe.
Just to take away this knight b4.
Well, a3 is possible, but it looks a bit strange for me. I don't know.
Is it? Yeah.
Okay. After three, black probably can play knight a5. For example, I will play knight a5. So f4, I can sacrifice on e4 again.
Again,
so
yeah.
So knight c4, knight b3.
Still some play.
Yeah. But a3 is interesting, of course. Well, actually, I'm glad with my decision, a3.
Oh, now you played.
Yes, I played. For example, take on c3, bc, take, 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 and f5. So, this I didn't like because my pawn on c3 is weak and bishop is also not so good. course, it was possible just to take on d3, knight d3, queen d3, and f5. Mm. It also works.
Looks fine for black,
yeah? Yeah, I think so. After e, f, knight, f6, so here are some ideas. Bishop b4, take on c3, and this square on e4 will be for a long time. Yes. So knight d3 I didn't like, and that's why I decided to play actively, okay. Like always. Take, take. Knight c6 and f5.
Okay, now it's just more like it.
Yeah, it's just only calculated during the games. I thought about queen c8.
Yes.
I wanted to play queen h5.
Yes.
Knight a5 and rook f3. So some crazy lines, but I like them all.
Like you're a natural attacking player, right? What is your typical... your style is just to go for go for the throat.
Well, actually, then I understood that instead of knight f5, knight d8 is better. But anyway, you can play rook f3. And then after knight e6, I even think that I can take on h6. So this is all I wanted to play.
Yeah. And was it possible to take on c3 with the queen? You don't mind, yeah? You just move the rook after rook f3.
Mm-hmm.
If queen takes c3, you just play rook.
Oh, you can just
rook
play
b1,
rook,
rook,
rook, rook, rook c1 with
rook
the tempo,
and
yes.
And then the same thing.
And then the same, I'll take on h6. So here my opponent played bishop g5. I kind of say that I expected this.
You did or you didn't?
No, yeah, I didn't
you
expect
didn't.
Just. But maybe black has some idea, for example, if I take now on g5, so... Oh, take on g5.
Yep.
Take, take, rook f5. And here, let me think, maybe rook ac8. Yes, rook ac8. Take, take, rook g3, rook c7. And, okay, rook c6, so rook c7. And I think that black here has compensation because I can't.
Yeah.
So I'm gain pawn up, but without good
black
ideas.
Is black is better, maybe.
No, I don't think that black is better here, but not worse, maybe.
Mm-hmm. So bishop g5 is a good move.
Well, it was a normal move. I'm not sure that it was the best. So knight c2.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Rook c8. Here I'm not so satisfied with this e6 move that I played. Of course, I could play rook f3 here.
It wasn't possible, sorry, to go back just to move. You couldn't play queen c8 after knight c2 and give a pawn up.
Queen
c8. And just play the same line with just losing some tempo here.
Now
it's not the same, is it?
But now it's not the same because my knight will go on
so
e3.
E3 quickly and attacks d5, yeah, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, I played e6 and during the game I also thought only about rook c7. But then after the game I realized that black could play just simply f6. And during the game, of course, I saw this f6, but... I thought that my pawn on e8 is very strong, on e6, sorry, on e6 is very strong, and but here I'm playing, so.
And your c3 pawn is
it's really
hanging, yeah.
I have no idea why I didn't think about this move, f6, so.
So he could have played this, yeah? He could have played
yeah, he could play, for example, if now rook a e1, yes. So knight e7, queen d3. Queen c7, and this pawn is really blocked on e6. So I think black is fine here.
Well, do you have to play bishop takes g5 and rook f3? What would you do then?
Yes, probably I have to take instead of rook ae1. But again, oh, okay, so it's hg. And what to play next is difficult to advise on. Okay, maybe white is not much worse here. I can play, for example, queen h3. But anyway, it's just not so pleasant.
Yeah.
So this act. And rook c7, of course, is also.
What do you think you should have played instead of e6?
Rook f3, as I said.
Rook f3.
Yeah, it's just a normal move. Just to protect this pawn on c3.
And bring the other rook to f1, maybe, afterwards.
It must be good for white. Anyway, it is better than what happened in the game. So e6, rook c7. And here g6. I have to say that I didn't calculate this move g6 at all. I just thought it's impossible.
Oh, it looks strange. Actually, yeah. Yeah, okay. Because of b6, f7 check. Mm-hmm.
So I thought only about rook e7. And here I wanted to play this end game. And I think it's. Okay, if with rook f8, then I can take on g5, so take a rook.
Yeah.
I think white is better here. So I expected to have this position in the game. Like queen d7, I take on d7, then take on f8. And
these pawns are very weak, huh? Weaker,
yeah,
I mean.
This d5, g5, and d7, yes, so yeah, that's why I think white is better.
Yeah.
G6.
Could he still have played f6 instead of g6? Was it still possible,
yeah,
or was it too late?
Maybe it was still possible, but of course earlier it was better for black to play.
Still to play knight e7 next move, same idea, yeah?
Mm-hmm. So g6. I took on f7, f. But now I think that bishop d5 firstly was better.
What's the difference?
The difference is that if queen g5, I can play queen h3 and just spin on f file. Well, this I didn't see during the game. This move.
Not to take on f7 yet, just to wait.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Just to wait, and now I have
knight
e3.
Mm-hmm.
And just. I think white is much better here. But I just thought that there is no difference. And they took on f7 immediately. Okay, here again I have a better position. So knight b4. And here I saw.
Okay, so you managed to lose your weakness on c3. Was that the point of knight b4? Because you had this weak pawn on c3 all the time.
Yes.
So now you've managed to get that pawn out.
So now I get rid of this weakness.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. So it's good for me, of course. During the game, I saw that I would play a rook endgame with a pawn up. And it almost happened in the game.
H3 you played?
Yes, I played h3. And because I started to calculate it, some lines like rook e5 and this pawn endgame. So, queen f2. Well, and I think that it is a drawish endgame. For example, h3, b5, and I don't see any chances for white. And here I had some ideas that, for example, after h3, rook f4, I can play rook e7, rook f7, take, take, and e4. So this was my idea. And here, yes.
And now it's maybe winning, yeah?
Yeah, maybe.
Because you have more free moves, you can get to a Zugzwang position, yeah? You can force him and get your king to g4.
This b5, I expected this one. and had some other plan, like rook c1, just to play rook c5 and to take this pawn on b5 and then rook a5. So, for example, if not a6, yeah, just to play immediately, I can take on b5. Then I will win the pawn on a7, and there are good winning chances. So.
Yeah.
But of course, this all is not so easy.
But essentially, why is white better? Because of black structure, yeah? Because of the double g pawns, that's the main.
Yes, okay, it's clear that white is better, but still it's difficult to win such kind of position. So a6 is good, I think. Here we repeated the moves. And I played king h2. It's strange because during the game I liked my position very much. And they thought that I have very good chances to win, but unfortunately, it is not true.
You think black should, with perfect play, should black hold this?
Yeah.
Do you think? Yeah.
Mm. And this happened in the game. Of course, king f6 is strong because, for example, if king h6, then.
Sorry, Maria, just go back to when he played. Excuse me, when he played rook f2.
When he played rook f2, but rook f2 is good move.
It's a good move, yeah. Just to show us. So what happens after rook takes d5? He just plays rook a2, does he? Yeah. Rook f2 is
rook
a good
rook
move.
Rook f2 is good move because I don't see the other schemes to play actively here.
Right. Yeah.
Okay, as I said, king h6 is not a good move because I win a pawn. Hmm. Rook d1, rook a6. Rook d4, d6, rook d3, rook b5. So it is good for black to activate the king. I took on a6. Rook a5. G4. I have to say that g4 is a good move.
Yes.
Yes. Mm. And it is if there is 13-9 small. So we
was there some time trouble? Was there
yes.
Some,
So I made this move AG on last seconds.
What could you also, could you play H4?
Of course, I thought about this. But I was afraid of some ideas like king f4, then d3, rook a1.
Yes.
And when I saw all of this, I understood that better to take on g4.
Not be checkmated.
No. Actually, I know what I think. I think that on g4, king f4, I have this rook a6.
Right.
So that's why g5 was better, firstly.
And then,
then if h5, I can play king f4 and g3 and g4, so it can be really dangerous.
And then, then you lose on the chief pawn. Yeah.
Hmm. Okay, I don't like to make such moves like h4 on some seconds because it's possible
because
to miss
absolutely
something.
Absolutely, yeah, you need to play a safe move because then you obviously you got the advantage if you play simply. Mm-hmm.
But here I understood that I don't have too much chances to win.
Also king g3 maybe was possible, was it?
King g3, okay, but I will just, I will not win a pawn. So for example, take, with, doesn't matter. Next
and
move.
Then king e4, and okay,
king
yeah.
King e4, king d4, and
it's true. It's true, okay.
My idea was just to win these both pawns after king e2, so rook. Okay, rook b5, rook a3, and then I can take on g6 and g5.
And then have to connect it.
Yes, and with
pawns,
these connected pawns, I can win this game.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, g5 is good.
So when you got to the time control, move 41, you could relax. Did you think you were going to win? Were you confident in winning or not?
No, after the fortress move, I understood that there are little chances for me.
Little chances only.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this 50 minutes couldn't help me to change my mind. And I started to calculate some lines like king d4, rook g5, king c4, rook g8. And here I was very happy that that I'm two pawns up. And I think that this position is winning. But of course, black can play just, for example, king e4. And then it all doesn't work. Like g6. And for example, rook a7. Rook a7. So I don't think it's possible to win all this. I think it's draw.
I think it's a draw. And after g7, rook e7, huh?
It's dangerous to play g7.
Yeah, so can be worse.
I think there are no ways for white to improve. Okay, here I had some idea to play rook f3. No, not rook a4, for sure. So rook f3. And after rook f3, of course, I win. So take. King g1, and this b4 pawn will be a queen soon. But here, rook a6, b5, rook b6, rook b3, and unfortunately, if
he's a pawn down, his king is so active in all these lines. Yeah,
it's true. Yeah, first day, I was very glad. When I saw rook f3, I thought, yeah, finally.
But to get behind the b-pawn.
Unfortunately, it doesn't.
Rook a6, it doesn't help,
So I played rook d6, but it's impossible to win such kind of position. Okay, rook b3 was also possible here.
Yeah, but you won this game, didn't you?
No.
That was a draw. Sorry, you won. I can see 1-0 on the screen now.
Okay, it's not my surname, you can see.
I'm waiting for the big blunder. Yeah. Okay, keep going.
Just rook b8 here. Okay, d5. So king g1 is the only way to play for a win. Do you know that here I could play d7, but... okay, rook d5 and d7. But it's really dangerous. I mean, after rook a5, can you two rook f7? Sometimes it can be unpleasant. For example, rook e3, rook e7, then take on g2, and you have to think what to do. So, okay, yes, that's rook d7, and we agreed. Draw.
And were you happy with the results? Or did you feel like you missed some? Because the opening was quite nice for you, yeah?
Well, I can't say that I'm happy with a draw, but it was a normal game, so I'm not so confused.
And he played well? He defended well?
I think yes.
He played the ending well, yeah? Did you look at the game afterwards with him? Did you have a look at the game?
No, after the game we didn't analyze. But I just checked some lines.
Any questions from the audience for Maria, either on the game she's just shown or maybe something else about chess or anyone?
I'll
yes?
Ask a question.
Yeah.
Do you prefer mixed tournaments or do you prefer playing?
Women, only women.
Do you prefer mixed tournaments or do you prefer women's tournaments? That's a good question.
It's difficult to say. I prefer both. So it depends. I just like to play against the strong players. So.
Right.
It's good for me to play at strong women tournaments and, for example, here at strong open tournaments.
Yeah.
I don't see any difference.
That was a question from Nigel Shaw.
Match, I mean, without giving anything away, but so you're playing Yifan. When is that match? It's in March?
It is going to start on the 1st of March.
1st of March? That's my birthday. Ah, yeah, it's my birthday. Good. Yeah, good.
Well, you can celebrate it in Lviv, yeah. And then the match will start.
It's going to start in your hometown.
Yeah, it's okay. My fault. They still try to arrange everything, so. Okay. But I think that it will be the opening ceremony, the closing ceremony will be in opera. Mm-hmm. And okay, we will know everything.
Right. And lots of spectators. Should be lots of spectators, people coming to watch.
I think so. Okay, sure, we have many strong players in Lviv, so yeah. Why not? Yeah. I think many people will come.
You played in the Ukrainian Championship recently, correct? In the, yes. Well, the men's in the Ukrainian Championship, yeah. How, what was that experience like?
Okay, it was of course was strong tournament. So yeah. It was interesting for me.
Okay.
Can I ask another question?
Of course you may. Yeah, another question.
That Ukrainian Championship. They didn't publish the games. What
is the reasoning behind that? Is that true? I read that they didn't publish her games, yeah?
Well,
games? I didn't.
It was our organizer's decision. As you know, there was no money for the online transmission. So, firstly, I thought that they wouldn't publish the game of all the players, but then they decided that they wouldn't publish only mine. So, as for me, I was much more focused on the tournament, and I knew that there were more than 1,000 of my games in database.
Already, yeah.
So, yes, so it was possible for everyone to prepare against me, and it is possible to do now.
Would you like us to stop publishing the rest of your games in Gibraltar? Any other questions for Maria?
All right, Maria.
Stuart, yeah?
How would you develop... We need more female participation in chess.
Right? <Yeah. laughs> I'm already doing this.
Yeah, I mean, lots of... I mean, you said something that surprised me a bit earlier, that just before you said the game, where you said the chess is... You said something like chess is not that popular in Ukraine, or something like that you said, which surprised
me.
Why? Tell us about that. Well, because thinks of the former Soviet Union and all the kind of Eastern European countries, whereas chess is relatively well established and followed, and people play a lot of chess, but that's not true.
Okay, it's obvious that football and the other some other sports are much more popular than chess.
Sure, okay.
Of course. I'm glad that my victory in Sochi made such a great influence. It's much more popular than it was before.
Thanks to your victory.
Yeah. And
yeah, okay. All right. So what are your plans? Well, of course, the World Championship is your next thing, yeah.
Yes. So, and after it, I still don't know. So.
And Anna will be your second,
I suppose. I hope so. You can ask her. Okay, good. She already agreed.
Yeah. All right, that's good. Okay, last question for Maria, otherwise... Okay, well, thank you very much for coming on the show.
Okay.
Good luck for the rest of your games.
Thank you.
And good luck in the World Championship match.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.